Kristie Ross. Dr. Ross is going to talk about something she worked on for a while, which is asthma and sleep disordered breathing. Kristie, give us an update.
All right. Okay, so thanks for having me and giving me the chance to talk about this once again. So learning objectives for everyone attending today is that you're able to list the risk factors and disease modifying factors that are shared between asthma and sleep disordered breathing. You can describe some of the proposed mechanisms that link these two disorders, and you're able to examine the evidence that treatment of sleep disordered breathing may influence asthma outcomes. So I'm going to start with just a little bit of background. Some people here are, you know, have a pulmonary background and very familiar with asthma. Others have a sleep background, very familiar with sleep disorders. So going to try to cover both things to catch, get everybody on the same page. So bear with me here. Asthma inception and severity is pretty complex. There's, you know, really no single thing that determines whether you have asthma and how severe it is, but it's an interaction between a number of host factors, lifestyle factors, and environmental influences. Some of the classic things we think about in terms of the individual is differences in sex. So boys are more likely to have asthma in early childhood. It's more likely to be severe, and then that changes post-puberty. Where women are more likely to have asthma than men, and it tends to be more severe, difficult to control. There are race and ethnicity factors such that minority children and adults are more likely to have asthma than non-minority races. Some Hispanic populations, particularly Puerto Rican backgrounds, are more likely to have asthma. There are certainly genetic factors, so there's asthma runs in families along with other atopic disorders. Sort of some of the newer work is on epigenetics, which is how genes are expressed, and that really gets into some of the interactions between the environment and your genetic background. And then we're going to talk about today some comorbidities that can influence the expression and severity of disease. In terms of lifestyle, many factors, nutrition, physical activity, stress can impact asthma. And then really importantly, a lot of things in the environment. So and this starts prenatally, exposure to air pollution, secondhand smoke, stress, and the mother has lasting impacts on the child's risk of having asthma or wheezing illnesses. That there are differences in that pattern based on the child's sex at birth, and then moving postnatally, daycare exposure, exposure to viral infections, location of the residents in schools, so neighborhood level factors, early viral infections, the microbiome, which is influenced by both viral infections, bacterial infections, and the environment. Exposure to allergens, pollutants, smoke, and then later in life, occupation. So pretty complex disorder with a lot of factors that go into the development and then the expression of the disease. And what this means is that it winds up being a very heterogeneous disorder. We've got asthma guidelines that haven't really changed substantially in terms of the basic recommendations to manage inflammation with inhaled corticosteroids over the last 20 to 30 years, although there have been some tweaks to that. And despite those guidelines and clinical trials that show that these drugs are successful in managing asthma in a majority of children, the real world situation is that many, many kids don't seem to respond fully to low dose inhaled corticosteroids. And those children who don't respond really account for the majority of the morbidity that we see in this disorder. So in terms of hospitalizations, limited ability to participate and play sports, miss school days for the kids, miss work days for the parents, medications are expensive, they have side effects. And then in some kids, we see this pattern of lost lung function that follows them into adulthood. So I'm just going to briefly share a study that I think, not because I want you to remember the details of it, but because it it really demonstrates that that we really do need an individual approach to therapies. So the Badger study was led by some folks from Wisconsin, hence the name Badger, and which stands for the best add-on therapy, something, something. But essentially, they, you know, they took the title of their study and made it, tweaked it to fit into the word Badger. But the goal of this study was to study children who were not able to achieve asthma control on low-dose inhaled corticosteroids and then randomize them in a crossover design to one of three different approaches, which was either adding another class of medication, a long-acting beta agonist, increasing the dose of the inhaled corticosteroid, or adding another class of medication, a leukotriene receptor antagonist. And this was a crossover design, so each participant in this study got all three of those approaches for a 16 to 18 week period, and then washed out, and then crossed over. So one of the things that were, one of the, I think, surprising features of this study to the people who participated in it and analyzed the data is that almost all of the children responded best to one of those three strategies. So there was a clear difference in their response pattern. So 161 out of the 165 children had a clear difference in response to one of those three strategies. And this bar graph over here shows you how those fell out. So a little over 45% responded best to long-acting beta agonist. And then the rest of the kids were really split between adding, going up to a higher strength of inhaled steroid or using a leukotriene receptor antagonist. So, you know, more of the kids responded to LABA, but a substantial proportion didn't, you know, that was not their best response. So this, and the things that we typically think about as, you know, might predict a response, like demographics, age, lung function, race, exposure to secondhand smoke, those kinds of things were not helpful in predicting where you would fall. So key message here is that there, for most kids, there's going to be a best approach, but it's going to be really, it's really hard to predict what that is. And so we need to think a little bit, take a little bit deeper dive into how we think about asthma and the way we classify it and phenotype it, because our standard things just aren't working. So when we see a kid in the clinic with asthma, you know, and they're not controlled, we use the guidelines and we use some common sense. And so, you know, one of the most important things is, are they taking the medications that we're prescribing? So, you know, if you're a cat, someone needs to jam the pill down your throat. But if you're a child with asthma, you need to have somebody pick up that medication, bring it home, help you take it, and in most cases use a spacer device to actually get the medication into your lungs. So it's not as simple as writing the prescription. We think about, you know, things that mimic asthma that aren't asthma or that may run along with it, that so maybe someone's not responding to our drugs because their primary problem is a vocal cord dysfunction problem rather than asthma, which is not going to respond to therapies. And then we think about things in the environment, like pests, smoke exposure, air pollution, all of those things. And then in addition to that, you know, those kind of common sense approaches, the guidelines recommend that we assess and address comorbid conditions. And this is the list of comorbid conditions that are explicitly laid out in the National Institutes of Health guidelines. It includes allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis, ABPA, which is relatively rare, but there's good evidence that if you treat it, you will improve outcomes. Gastroesophageal reflux disease, somewhat controversial about, you know, whether treating it, if it's not symptomatic, actually improves asthma, although if it's symptomatic and you treat it, then you do tend to see improvement. Obesity, OSA, rhinitis and sinusitis, and stress. And we're going to talk a little bit more about, as you can see today, about, in particular about the obesity and OSA connections. So I'm going to shift now and talk a little bit about kind of what are some of the things that asthma and sleep disorder breathing share in terms of risk factors and potential disease modifiers, and get a little and then get into a little bit about some of the ways that that we have to think about both disorders, the complexity of that, and how there's some overlap in that. So starting at the kind of outside edges of the Venn diagram, the things that, you know, probably are more particular to asthma, although I think you could make some arguments that there's early data and some of these things that they're also shared things, but in particular, viral infections early in life seem to influence whether a child is going to continue to have problems with wheezing and asthma later in life. The microbiome is a really hot topic. It's a complex, you need to use complex analysis techniques to really understand the relationship between the microbiome and asthma, and there's some work now in sleep-disordered breathing as well. Occupational exposures, stress, prenatal exposures, and, you know, as I said, in children at least, in early childhood, boys are more likely to have asthma. Post-puberty, women are more likely to have asthma. And that relationship is not, there are different relationships with sex in sleep-disordered breathing. So that's listed over on the outside edge of the Venn diagram with sleep-disordered breathing. There's, you know, a number of things that go into the development of sleep-disordered breathing, as most people know on the call, including craniofacial structure, neuromuscular components, the control of breathing or loop gain. And then we do see differences in sex. So in young kids, pretty equal distribution, and then as you go through puberty, tends to be more common in men than women, at least until you get to throughout until women hit menopause, and then we start to see some of those differences go away. And then there are all the things that, you know, that seem to be shared between these two disorders. So certainly both asthma and sleep-disordered breathing are more prevalent in certain races and ethnicity, ethnic backgrounds, atopic disease, rhinitis, sinusitis are shared risk factors, obesity, GERD, metabolic syndrome, or insulin resistance. There are some shared genetic background factors, smoke exposure, and then neighborhood level factors. I can't see anybody's faces while I'm talking, so if anyone has a question or anything like that, please speak up, unmute yourself, because I won't notice the way I have my screen set up. So,
Kristie, could I ask a question about predisposing factors? And is there anything in the particular in the aerodigestive tract in terms of growth and development of the coordination of those things that has any particular recognized role?
That's a great question, Kingman. And I think, you know, the aerodigestive growth and development and disorders in young children that where there's overlap between the airway and the digestive tract is really ripe for investigation. So that, you know, there has been an explosion in clinical diagnostic centers called aerodigestive centers, where children are seen, you know, by multi-specialty providers in the same clinic. So ENT, GI, pulmonary, surgery in some cases, nutrition, speech, occupational therapy. And from a clinical standpoint, there is just tremendous overlap in, you know, young kids with wheezing, noisy breathing, and those who have swallowing disorders. Impaired control of breathing, probably differences in response to CO2 and oxygen, although that's really not well understood, gastroesophageal reflux disease. So I think the answer to your question is yes, there is something there, but we don't really know what that something is yet. And there's really been very little basic science or translational work to understand those mechanisms, but I think it's an area that is really ripe for investigation. I don't know if Dan wants to add anything to that from his standpoint in pulmonary.
I'd probably leave that for another session.
Because I've always been a nose guy. I the nose and the lungs and the treat the nose and treat the lungs, and then you look at that. That's the 80s and 90s. They had a lot of work on that. But right.
I remember you. The nose bone is connected to the lung bone, right?
And Denise is commenting that neuroendocrine bodies are from the gills. So okay.
Yeah. Oh, thanks. Yeah, I can't see the chat at all. I don't know.
All right.
Sorry. Goofy. So I'm gonna keep moving here. I'm taking a long time to get through the first few slides here. So quickly some of the other shared, things, complexities in these disorders. So I think, one of the difficulties in studying the relationship between asthma and sleep disordered breathing is that both are complex and in a number of ways. So one, making the diagnosis and the definition of having one of these disorders is complicated, and you can do it in a number of ways for both. So asthma epidemiologically, we often ask about a history of a physician diagnosis or use a screening questionnaire. In clinical trials, we, will more likely use a physiologic definition with reversible airway obstruction. Sleep disorder breathing, same thing. We define it by questionnaires, everything ranging from questionnaires and parent report of habitual snoring all the way through, limited channel studies and then in lab polysomnography. So those are probably going to be different disorders depending on how they're defined. There's different clinical phenotypes in both these disorders. They're heterogeneous. So, I mentioned that already in asthma that, so some kids are very atopic. There can be a neutrophilic predominance to the pathobiology. It could be more of a loss of anti-inflammatory regulatory cells, could be triggered by oxidative stress and air pollution exposure, smoke exposure. And then this concept of having an abnormal epithelial cell barrier that allows allergens and viral infections to influence the lungs in a way that is not seen in kids with a more intact barrier. Sleep disordered breathing, Carol taught me well, when you look in a kid's mouth, you can't tell if they're going to have sleep disordered breathing or not just from an awake exam, because it's not just about the tonsil size, it's also about the airway collapsibility, muscle responsiveness, the child's arousal threshold, response to CO2, and loop gain. So all of those things, are different disorders, at least in some way. So, and then that translates into sort of the clinical phenotypes that we use. So, all this is to say that it's pretty complicated, similar things with response to treatment, right? So, pretty complicated. And unfortunately, the majority of studies don't make an attempt to really understand the underlying type of asthma, the underlying type of sleep disorder breathing. And so the result of that is that it's there's a lot of muddy waters out there. All right. So I do want to spend a little bit of time just thinking about kind of some of the potential mechanisms of the relationship. And I'm going to do this broken down by different categories. So the first is physiology. So if we think about OSA, sleep disordered breathing, and how it might impact asthma. You have an increased resistance load when the upper airway collapses, and that could, clearly trigger the inflammation in the lower airway. There can be vagal-mediated bronchoconstriction that's elicited by upper airway collapse. During sleep, you have a reduction in your FRC, and that is exacerbated in OSA, which can lead to increased airway resistance. And then thinking about the other way around, sleep disruption due to asthma can have effects on upper airway muscle tone. Bronchoconstriction in the lower airways can reduce the pharyngeal cross-sectional area and lead to potentially more OSA. And as Kingman taught me, there's really interdependence between the lower airway and the upper airway in terms of flow resistance. There's this concept of reduced tracheal tug in asthma that can lead to increased upper airway resistance as well. another category is thinking about how might inflammation and oxidative stress relate. So in OSA, you know, there's good data that there is local inflammation, particularly neutrophilic, with elevated NF-kappa-B. There's evidence that there's increased cystinyl leukotrienes, which is why, you know, those drugs that modify that pathway may be helpful in some people with OSA. But those chemokines and cytokines and cell types can influence the lower airways as well. It's all connected. Intermittent hypoxemia due to OSA may trigger further bronchoconstriction via vagal nerve stimulation and also trigger neutrophilic inflammation, which could result in asthma or asthma-like symptoms. And then the systemic inflammation that, you know, in addition to local inflammation that can occur. In then thinking about the other direction, so asthma results in this chronic low-grade, or is characterized by chronic low-grade inflammation, which may influence the upper airway force generation properties, this inflammatory spillover from rhinosinusitis that is linked to asthma and to the pharynx, and then things that I've just lumped into other, but in many cases maybe as I'm looking at this or thinking about it, maybe one way to classify some of these would be that aerodigestive metabolic pathway came in that you mentioned. So leptin and adipokines are altered in both disorders, and there's some evidence that that these, you know, can influence disease severity in asthma. GERD, we talked about, sleep disruption. One interesting thing to think about in the way we treat asthma is that the inhaled steroids we use may actually directly influence the upper airway tone and caliber, which could then predispose to, you have sort of a steroid myopathy in the upper airway, which could predispose to OSA. The additive effects of smoking and pollution, and then GERD-induced upper airway changes. So lots and lots of potential mechanisms, and probably, you know, in any individual patient, there's going to be a variety of things that could be playing a role. All right, so I'm going to move on to some of the epidemiology that shows there's a link between these disorders, and then talk about a couple of prospective studies and then some data that or a study that will hopefully shed additional light when it's done, still in progress. So in terms of epidemiology, there are many, many studies showing that asthma prevalence is higher than would be expected in other in children with sleep apnea and sleep disordered breathing, and in adults as well. So I don't have time to go into, you know, detail on all of these, but just, you know, consistent findings. And this is an insurance database case control study out of Israel that showed in adults with PSG confirmed sleep apnea, when matched with age and gender match controls, the diagnostic codes of asthma and COPD were more prevalent in those with OSA compared to controls. In the CHAT study, the childhood adenotonsillectomy study, this was not collected all that systematically, but parent report of asthma in those children was quite high, so 30%, about three times what you would expect in that age group otherwise. And then there's a similar reporting rate in another retrospective multi-center study of children undergoing treatment for sleep disordered breathing. This is old data, but still very relevant and done here in Cleveland. Susan Redline, I think Carol, you were involved in this study as well, I believe. So the Cleveland Family Study recruited 400 children ages 2 to 18, including children with sleep disordered breathing and controls. This was a pretty a very conservative definition of sleep disordered breathing. So you had an AHI above 10, and to be put in the no sleep disordered breathing, you had an AHI less than 5. So the kind of the middle of the road kids were left out. In adjusted and unadjusted and adjusted models, having lower respiratory tract other upper respiratory tract and then lower respiratory tract symptoms like wheezing, cough, history of asthma, all substantially increased the risk of sleep disordered breathing, the odds, I should say. Other studies showing that sleep disordered breathing and sleep apnea prevalence is high in populations with asthma. So in a retrospective study of adults at a tertiary care center, those with an OSA diagnosis had were predicted by, so the women in this tertiary care clinic with moderate to severe asthma, those with more severe asthma and higher ICS doses were more likely to have a diagnosis of OSA either by chart review or by a screening questionnaire. In a retrospective case control study of a lot of asthmatics in the National Health Insurance data source in Taiwan, there was an increased hazard risk for developing OSA in patients with asthma. In a couple of studies in children, similar things. So cross-sectional analysis of 108 children with asthma, there's a high prevalence of obesity and a high prevalence of habitual snoring, along with a high prevalence of sleep disordered breathing, which was diagnosed with home studies. Another case control study of children with asthma. So those children with asthma that were much more likely to have a positive screen for sleep disordered breathing with a PSQ than those without. And that relationship got stronger as the severity of asthma increased. This is also another study from Cleveland, the Cleveland Children's Sleep Health Study, which enrolled children, school-aged children, enriched for having been born preterm and African-American. This shows that the percent of kids who had a diagnosis of OSA, which was an AHI of 5 or greater, was higher in kids with a history of wheezing and asthma compared to no wheezing or asthma, which is the blue bars. Sleep disordered breathing was the definition was habitual snoring and similar findings. So higher prevalence in those with a history of wheezing or asthma compared with no asthma or wheezing. When the modeling was done to look to see if there was, and there were similar findings with obesity and asthma, and when they did some modeling to look to see whether sleep disordered breathing modified that relationship, there was a partial explanation. So some of the relationship between obesity and wheezing was explained by the presence of sleep disordered breathing. So in addition to just, you know, does sleep disordered breathing, what's the relationship between them, and then from an epidemiologic standpoint, is there evidence that there's association between sleep disordered breathing and poor asthma control? And the answer to that is yes. So several studies have shown that having OSA is associated with an increased risk of poor asthma control when controlled for other things, more symptoms, more medication use, more healthcare utilization in both adults. So this is adults in the Severe Asthma Research Program, which is a longstanding cohort study with extensively phenotyped patients with asthma. And then also in the children in the Inner City Asthma Consortium. So habitual snoring was associated with worse asthma outcomes in those children as well. So this is sort of more symptom-based. And then in terms of asthma exacerbations, the likelihood that you fell into an exacerbation phenotype was increased in a study done in Europe in the early 2000s. If you had OSA, you had a longer length of stay and charges and asthma hospitalizations, and habitual snoring was found to be associated with increased healthcare utilization, and another in that same inner city asthma consortium study. So those studies that I just described were all retrospective or association studies. So we studied prospectively whether in a cohort of children with asthma, whether having sleep-disordered breathing at baseline predicted, or other sleep disorders predicted, difficulty obtaining asthma control using guidelines-based care. So these were children recruited from our tertiary care asthma center. We did a number of in-home measurements, including a limited channel home sleep study, actigraphy, dietary assessments, nutrition assessments. They had visits done in the, or assessments done in the clinic to characterize weight, presence of obesity and overweight, in addition to some phenotyping of obesity and overweight. They had a visit after those measurements were done to provide feedback on the findings and provide some healthy lifestyle and asthma education, in addition to sort of the standard asthma management that was done through the clinical program. And then we assessed asthma and severity and control at 6-month intervals over the next 2 years. Children who were found to have a sleep problem, either sleep disordered breathing or short sleep, were referred for formal in-lab polysomnography or a sleep center visit. Children who were found to have metabolic syndrome or hyperlipidemia or hypertension were referred to endocrinology and or weight management program for management. So the definitions we used in this study were sleep disordered breathing was defined as habitual loud snoring and desaturation index on the home sleep study. Sorry, turn my phone notifications off. Habitual loud snoring and a desaturation index on the limited channel sleep study of 3 or higher using a 4% desaturation. And then we used a composite measure to assess asthma control that included having a low score, a lot of symptoms on a questionnaire, a standardized questionnaire about asthma symptoms, a high level of medication therapy, hospitalizations, or oral corticosteroid courses. And so these are pretty severe kids. So this is a really high level of therapy, 2 or more hospitalizations in a year, 3 or more corticosteroids courses. So these are kids that are really significantly impacted in the what we would call severe asthma. So what we found is that children who had sleep disordered breathing at baseline were 3 times more likely to have poor asthma control at the end of that follow-up period after adjusting for race, BMI score, and sex. There was some modification by BMI so that children with a higher BMI Z score were more likely to have, were more likely to be impacted by sleep disordered breathing in terms of the relationship between that and asthma severity. So if there's evidence that sleep disordered breathing adversely impacts asthma, I think a logical question is, if we treat it and we target it, does that improve asthma outcomes? So I have a couple of cases to discuss. We're doing okay on time, yeah. So the first one is a 18-month-old with autism speech delay came in to see me in my pulmonary clinic for chronic cough. The cough improved on low-dose inhaled steroids. And then, like most parents, things got better, and so they stopped using it. We're lost to follow-up in the clinic, the pulmonary clinic, for a year, during which there were a bunch of episodes of wheezing and oral corticosteroid courses. So low-dose inhaled corticosteroids were restarted, and then the child was evaluated at age 3 in sleep clinic for snoring, restless sleep, choking, and gasping that had worsened over the prior year, and had a PSG that showed what would be classified as mild obstructive sleep disordered breathing. This was what Carol would call a challenging study with intermittent loss of sensors or lack of sensors. So potentially an underestimate, but with an OHI of around 3. So the child, because of all the symptoms, was referred for adenotonsillectomy, came back to see me. After that, it had resolution of snoring and then significant progression in language acquisition. So it had some language delay, speech delay, thought to be related to the autism diagnosis. And also had improved significantly in terms of exacerbations of wheezing since the surgery. So had had a couple of URIs in the winter without lower respiratory tract symptoms. And again, they really did not want to keep the kid on inhaled corticosteroids. So and thinking about that, so what is the evidence that treatment of OSA can actually improve asthma outcomes? So adenoid tonsillectomy is first-line treatment in children with OSA if they're surgical candidates. We do know from some studies that asthma is a risk factor for incomplete response to adenoid tonsillectomy in non-obese children, at least in a retrospective study. The CHAT study did not systematically collect this data. What is sort of anecdotally present is that kids with asthma had who were in the early adenoid tonsillectomy study there were fewer asthma-related AEs, asthma exacerbations reported than those in the watchful waiting group. It's not clear how meaningful that was because of the way these things are reported, but it's of interest. The Gozals attempted to try to address this question of whether adenoid tonsillectomy improved asthma outcomes in a retrospective analysis of their experience at their center. So they retrospectively studied 135 poorly controlled asthmatics, most of whom were referred for PSG, half of whom were found to have OSA on the PSG, and a proportion of those, went from there to have adenoid tonsillectomy. There's a lot of loss of follow-up in this study because it was essentially a retrospective analysis of clinical practice. Because of that, there's certainly a lot of potential for the introduction of bias. What they tried to do, I think, to address some of the bias is to choose outcomes that are less subjective and more, less prone to bias in determining whether or not they happened. So asthma exacerbations, so those who had OSA, who had the adenoid tonsillectomy and follow-up, there was a reduction in the rate of asthma exacerbations per year, pre and post, less weekly beta agonist use, and then an improvement in lung function. In children who did not have OSA, who had similar follow-up, those things did not change over time. So they tried to control for those kids that were followed. So some evidence that perhaps adenoid tonsillectomy can improve asthma outcomes, although not in a lot of limitations here. Other data that suggests it can improve asthma outcomes. So maybe that child that I saw would be safe without inhaled steroids. So this is a database of privately insured children in the U.S. Because it's a database, lots and lots of cases identified 13,000 children with an asthma diagnosis who had an adenoid tonsillectomy and had data for 1 year before and 1 year after that adenoid tonsillectomy compared with a 2-to-1 number of controls. These were school-age kids, more likely to be boys, and they had showed improvement in asthma outcomes in the children who had the adenoid tonsillectomy with asthma compared to those who did not. And that was driven really by the prevalence of acute exacerbations, which was defined by use of oral corticosteroids, and then also status asthmaticus, which was an emergency room or hospital visit. So again, retrospective data, but large scale. Another insurance database study done in Belgium that represents about 40% of the Belgian population. Again, children with who underwent tonsillectomy and or adenoidectomy, 1 year data before the surgery, 1 year data post. Of those who used respiratory medications in year one, the use of respiratory medications was reduced from the number of canisters filled in the year prior to the year after, both in all subjects and then with a particular difference in those who used a lot of canisters pre and post. So that brings us to the PATH study, which is a prospective clinical trial that is nearly complete in terms of data collection. So these are children three to 12 years of age who have habitual snoring and mild sleep disorder breathing, which is defined as having an AHI less than 3 on an in-lab polysomnogram. These kids are randomized to either early adenotonsillectomy or watchful waiting for a year. And we learned some lessons from what had happened in chat and did a little bit more systematic data collection about asthma. So defined it in a number of ways, including using a well-validated Isaac questionnaire, and then are following the kids throughout the study with additional validated questionnaires of a composite asthma severity index that includes sort of symptoms, medication use, and exacerbations. So most of you have heard about the PATH study before. So the primary outcome, the primary goal of this study is to determine whether children with mild sleep disordered breathing benefit from early adenotonsillectomy. So, and the primary outcome is executive function and attentional vigilance with some testing. So as I said, we don't have those data yet. Their data lock is imminent. I think Carol can speak more to that. But what we do know is that similar to chat, asthma is common in the kids who were enrolled in this study. So a little over half reported wheezing ever, and 34% reported wheezing in the prior 12 months. 25% reported receiving an asthma diagnosis from a physician. Many had an ED visit in the prior 12 months, steroids in the prior 12 months, and a hospitalization in the last 12 months. And so not only do we see that asthma is pretty common in this group, which will hopefully give us some power to look at how adenotonsillectomy influences asthma outcomes in these kids, there's also a pretty nice distribution of asthma severity. So this is a histogram of the composite asthma severity index score, which ranges from 0 to 15. Anything 4 or higher is considered to be moderate to severe asthma. So there's a red line here at 4, and about half the kids fell into that category. So even at a relatively young age. How are we doing on time? Okay. So we look forward to that data. So we'll be looking to see whether children in the early adenotonsillectomy group have differences in asthma severity over time compared with those in the watchful waiting group. A logical question, is if in addition to adenotonsillectomy, another common therapy for sleep apnea is CPAP. So what is the evidence that CPAP can influence asthma outcomes? And by the way, that kid that I saw, I did take off inhaled daily and he had corticosteroids and never saw them again. So I hopefully that meant they were doing well. And in the chart review, there was, no further visits with the primary care provider for issues with their asthma or with wheezing. So this is another patient that I saw in my asthma clinic, 14-year-old with worsening symptoms. He's somewhat complicated, has a history of epilepsy, developmental delay that's mild. Had been seen 3 years prior in asthma clinic and had normal lung function and was doing well. And then 6 months before the visit to me, he had foot surgery that was complicated by osteomyelitis in a wheelchair for a long time. And during that time developed significant and progressive shortness of breath. He also had significant weight gain. And when we saw him in clinic, he had a substantial decline in lung function from normal to moderate obstruction that was reversible. So was having increasing seizure frequency and then a lot of nighttime symptoms that can be difficult to determine whether they were related to seizures versus asthma versus sleep apnea. So he had a pretty big workup. I was concerned about something other than asthma because of his dyspnea and the rapid progression of it. Chest CT was normal. He had some improvement on stepping up his asthma therapy, but still some symptoms, and had a little bit of an improvement in his lung function. And at this point, although I had ordered a PSG, it hadn't been done yet. So then it did get done, and this is the hypnogram from our old system. So he had relative relatively normal sleep stage cycling of some fragmentation that was related to epileptiform activity. We saw a number of different positions. He had primarily REM-related obstructive events with pretty modest desaturations. It was more and normal CO2. So classified as mild, the AHI was 5 without a lot of evidence for gas exchange abnormalities. So he had already had his tonsils and adenoids out as a younger child. So he, because of all of his symptoms, even though it was mild, we started CPAP, did a titration and started it. And he had a pretty dramatic improvement in his lung function, his BMI, and then also his sort of quality of life. So daytime shortness of breath, sleepiness, and also frequency of seizures. So what's the evidence in, you know, the evidence out in the literature that CPAP can improve asthma outcomes? It's not great. There's some. The first report was back in the 80s in patients with uncontrolled asthma who had had mild to moderate sleep disordered breathing, OSA. This is an uncontrolled study that showed some improvement in daytime, nighttime symptoms and asthma control. Another uncontrolled series showed reduction in nocturnal asthma attacks. Subsequent studies showed that CPAP may impact lung function, in particular those with obstructive lung disease on PFT. And then I'm going to fly through this a little bit so that there's time for some discussion. A couple other uncontrolled studies that showed some mixed findings of improvement in some patients, not so much improvement in others, sometimes improvement in, most of the improvement tended to be in quality of life and symptoms rather than improvement in pulmonary function testing. In almost all these studies, the adherence to all of the therapies, asthma and CPAP, were not fantastic. So there's enough data that somebody was able to do a systematic review of 12 studies that examined the relationship between the use of CPAP and asthma outcomes in patients with OSA. And again, the forest plot here shows that there is improvement. So to the right here is improvement in asthma symptoms and quality of life, that the overall findings were there was improvement in quality of life, but no improvement as it crosses the zero line here in lung function. Somebody also studied a group in the American Lung Association Clinical Trial Network studied whether CPAP could improve asthma outcomes in patients who do not have OSA. So this is based on some animal model work that CPAP can improve airway hyperactivity. So these were patients with stable asthma, no OSA by report or by screening questionnaire. They were randomized either to sham or sham CPAP or CPAP with a 5 or 10 centimeter water pressure. And there was no difference in any of those groups, although adherence to CPAP in this study was, I think, around 1.5 to 2 hours a night on average. So not so great. That was a lot of data that is mostly retrospective, mostly very little in the way of randomized controlled trials, and complicated by the fact that both asthma and obstructive sleep disorder breathing are heterogeneous conditions and difficult. There's a lot of ways to define both of them. Hopefully I've convinced you that they're both prevalent. There's overlapping physiologic, inflammatory, metabolic, and environmental factors that could explain the interaction between them. Treatment of sleep disorder breathing potentially may improve asthma outcomes, and we hope to have a little bit more vigorous data on that soon, understand if that's true, at least in children with habitual snoring. I will close there and open to any questions folks have. And of course, thank Carol and all of the other folks who've participated in chat, PATS, and the study, our prospective study back in the 2010s when we did that.
Sometime like that, right.